atmosphere. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? Real simple song. I want to teach it to you tonight. The Lord is my light, salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light, salvation. Whom shall I fear? Yeah. Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. I will wait on you. You, yes. I will trust in you. Yes, Lord, say. I will trust in you. Y'all help me. The Lord is my light. Everybody sing. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? You say it. Whom shall I be afraid? No, no. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? No, no. Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait. Hey, I will wait on you. Yeah, say it again. Say, I will trust in you. Yeah, sing. I will trust in you. The next part goes like this. Listen, I want you to go home singing this. I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord. You say, I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to New Creation United Methodist Church. We want to welcome the Schuler family as well as all of our other visitors. Before proceeding to worship, we have a few announcements we would like to make. Again, our strategic planning is still in motion, and we'd like you to look at the board for the three strategic priorities that we are committed to. Adult Sunday School will meet via Zoom today at 2 p.m. The SPPRC will be meeting on Zoom Monday, July 31st at 6:30 p.m. And Noonday Bible Study will meet again this Wednesday on Zoom at 12 p.m. And my farewell reception will be next Sunday following church, so invite you to come to that. Also, we ask for prayers and condolences for our names and saints on the board. Our deepest sympathy to Calvin Coleman for the loss of his father, Calvin Coleman Sr. The funeral service was held Sunday, July 23rd in Mississippi. May God comfort him as he mourns, and cards and flowers and other condolences may be sent to the address on the screen. Happy birthday to Omieda Henry, August 3rd. We would also like to announce that the anniversary of Albert and Jimmy Schuler today. In this portion, we are going to move to the joys and concerns. So if you have anything, I will bring the mic to you.
My joy this morning is to see our former pastor, Reverend Schuler, his beloved wife, Jimmy, and we truly welcome you. It's always a blessing to see the lovely smile on your face. God bless.
Good morning. What I have to say is not a happy thing, but it's something that I tell the family that I would request from this wonderful body of people. My sister-in-law's niece is suffering with Guillain-Barré, and she's in the hospital at Winston-Salem, and it's really bad, and it's so hard for the whole family. And when I talked to the mother, I said, "What can we do?" She said, "Please pray." So that's all we have to hold on to is pray and try to get other people to pray. Her name is Claudette Walls. Please pray for her. Thank you.
Good morning. I have a joy this morning. On July the 28th, my mother celebrated her 80th birthday.
Well, it'd be great if every one of us could stand up and say this, but it is so great to have the Schulers here. I have to repeat that again and again. Thanks so much for the ministries of y'all and whatever your future is now.
Good morning. I'm so glad to have friends from Atlanta here, from Hoosier Memorial United Methodist Church, and also Bria's gonna be at Tar Heel. She's gonna be at, wow. at UNC at the School of Public Health, and her dear friend came to help her move in. That's what you call a real friend, who will come and help you move in, but we're so glad they're here today.
Good morning. I don't know whether this is a joy or a concern. It's probably a joy for me, but maybe a concern for Brandy. We are getting married here at the church August 12th. We would love to see everybody here. So that's Saturday, August 12th. If she doesn't change her mind before then, it's 2 weeks away. Made with me this long. She just gotta get through another 2 weeks. But yeah, we would love to see you August 12th at 2 p.m. Unfortunately, due to budget and size, we did have to keep the reception small and have it off site, but we definitely would love to see everybody at the ceremony. So that's Saturday, August 12th at 2 p.m.
Allow me to offer a brief word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, and I just lift up all the joys and the concerns and everything that was said and unsaid. And I just ask that you meet your people where they are, that your name be glorified, and that all things your people may be comforted. And I pray for blessings on your people in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you're willing and able, please stand for our call to worship. Sing God's praise. Seek the Lord and trust God's strength.
Obey God's wonderful works.
Live in the spirit of love and grace.
Give thanks for Christ's promise of love.
And now our opening prayer. Spirit of God, you intercede for us with sighs too deep for words. When all seems lost, you heal our hearts and give us strength to carry on. Set our hearts and minds on you, great Spirit, that we may know your abiding presence and your never failing love. Amen. Please remain standing for the opening hymn.
Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our first scripture reading comes from Genesis 29:15-28. Laban said to him, "Just because you are a relative of mine, should you work for me for nothing? Tell me what your wages should be." Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah had weak eyes, but Rachel had a lovely figure and was beautiful. Jacob was in love with Rachel and said, "I'll work for you 7 years in return for your younger daughter, Rachel." Laban said, "It's better that I give her to you than to some other man. Stay here with me." So Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel, but they seemed like only a few days to him because of his love for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife. My time is completed and I want to make love to her." So Laban brought together all the people of the place and gave a feast. But when evening came, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and Jacob made love to her. And Laban gave his servant Zilpah to his daughter as her attendant. When morning came, there was Leah. So Jacob said to Laban, "What is this you have done to me? I served you for Rachel, didn't I? Why have you deceived me?" Laban replied, "It isn't our custom to give the younger daughter in marriage before the older one. Finish this daughter's bridal week, then we will give you the younger one also, in return for another 7 years of work." And Jacob did so. He finished the week with Leah, and then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel to be his wife. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed which a man took and planted in his field. Though it is the smallest of all seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree so that the birds come and perch in its branches. He told them still another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 60 pounds of flour until it worked all through the dough.
The parable of the hidden treasure and the pearl. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When the man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. The parable of the net. Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore and then sat down and collected the good fish in baskets but threw the bad away.
This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the blazing furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things? Jesus asked. Yes, they replied. He said to them, therefore every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. The word of God for the people of God.
Praise be to God.
Amen, amen. To God be the glory. Amen. Come on, let's give God a praise for the things that he has done and that he continues to do. We thank God for our presence here this morning. I echo everyone else. It is a pleasure to have the Shula family worshiping with us. And particularly to see Reverend and Dr. Jimmy Shula, pastors, a former pastor of this church. Welcome home. We're so glad to have you all visiting with us this morning. Our scripture lesson, as you can see, will come from Paul's letter to the Romans, and it begins in chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. Hear the word of the Lord. What then are we to say? Yeah, we'll do the word a little bit later. So again, we just thank you for your presence here. Our topic this morning is what's love got to do with it, coming from that text. In 1984, the queen of rock and roll, the late Tina Turner, released the single, What's Love Got to Do With It? Tina Turner never intended to record this song, but it was one of her greatest hits, selling over 2 million copies. And it helped her to win a Grammy. Many of us probably know the lyrics to that song, but I won't ask you to sing this morning. What's surprising about this song is that it is an anti-love song about a woman who feels no emotional attachment or commitment to her significant other. The attraction is purely physical. In this song, she says that love is nothing more than a secondhand emotion. What's love got to do with it? The word love describes a human emotion that people crave from the moment of their existence. We hear amazing stories of love, the love of a husband for a wife, or wife's love for her husband, the love of parents for their children, or the love of someone who has stood by a friend in a time of need. We all want to be loved. There are four distinctive forms of love described in Scripture: Eros love, which is a sensual or romantic love. And we see a vivid picture of Eros love in our Old Testament reading for today. You heard it, Jacob loved Rachel so much that he worked for her father for 7 years to have her as his bride. And then after being tricked by her father, Jacob agreed to work an additional 7 years for Rachel because he loved her. And then there is storge, a Greek word that describes family love, the affectionate bond that develops naturally between parents and their children, such as Jacob's love for his 12 sons, or the love between siblings, such as Martha and Mary and Lazarus. And then there's philia love, which describes the emotional love that is found in friendships. Someone dearly loved, a trusted confidant, the kind of person that you would love who is your BFF or your ride or die. Philia love also means brotherly love, care, respect, and compassion for people in need. And philia love also identifies us as followers of Christ. Jesus said, "By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." So love sets us apart. And then the highest level of love is agape love. Agape love is God's immeasurable, incomparable, unconditional, unimaginable, unfailing love for humankind. It is a divine love that comes only from God. And there is no comparison to agape love. Agape love is perfect. It's sacrificial and pure. What's love got to do with it? So hear the word of the Lord from Romans 8, verses 31 through 39. What then shall we say about these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, how will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died. Yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will affliction or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake, we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, not powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. This section of Romans 8 is subtitled God's Love in Christ. This text is one of the most loved in the Bible. Paul begins and ends Romans with declarations about the security that we have in Christ and the depth of God's grace and love for us. As you notice, verse 1 begins with the assurance that there is now, he said, no condemnation for those who belong to Christ. He said, now, because we're no longer under the law, but we're under grace because of the cross of Christ. And then verse 39 ends with the assurance that nothing will be able to separate us from God. Now that's love. Thanks be to God. And so the confidence and the assurance that we have in God's love and grace is because of the cross. Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. In this text, Paul asks a series of rhetorical questions. When I read this scripture, I thought of the game show Jeopardy, which, as many of you know, has a question and answer format. How many people watch Jeopardy? Okay. How many people can get most of the questions correct? The host reads a clue, as you know, in the form of an answer from a specific category, and the contestants respond in the form of a question. For example, suppose there was a biblical category called places. The clue might read, along with Gomorrah, God rained brimstone on this community for their wickedness, saving only the families of Lot and Abraham. And so the response would be in the form of a question, which would be, what is Sodom? Okay, I do have some Jeopardy watchers. And so this morning, I want you to wholly imagine with me that Paul is doing a virtual worship service using the question and answer format of Jeopardy. Well, we're just going to have a slight variation. I invite you to participate by reading the questions together. And then let's see what Paul is saying to the Christians in Rome and all believers. And the category for this morning is the magnitude of God's love. Okay. So the first question, let's read it together.
What then are we to say about these things?
Okay, so this first question, what then are we to say about these things, helps us to frame this entire passage. So what are these things that Paul is referring to? These things are the freedom and the hope that we have in Christ, the Holy Spirit that's living in us, and the promise of no condemnation for those who have faith in Christ. These things are proof of God's unfailing love. So what are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? Now this is a conditional clause. A conditional clause is a supposition, a fact that is supposed, which may or may not be true, depending on the fulfillment of certain specified conditions. Now, in this context, there is no doubt that God is for us. Every condition has been met in Jesus Christ. And the Amplified Bible reads this way, since God, not if God, but since God, is for us, who can be successful against us? Paul is saying, don't worry about your adversaries because God is for you. So that gives us a new perspective on anything that threatens to destroy us, people or circumstances. The prophet Isaiah said that no weapon formed against us would succeed. He did not say now that weapons would not be formed, but he said that they would not succeed. So let me say that another way. God is bigger than anything that we may face. God is for us, God will protect us. Which moves us into the next question that Paul posed. Great question. This is the ultimate proof of God's great love for God's people. Humanity received the gift of all time when God gave up Jesus Christ to pay the penalty for our sins. So we can be confident that God will graciously give us all things, earthly needs and spiritual blessings. Now, that does not mean that everything we want, God will give it to us. So don't start naming and claiming this morning. What we want is not always what we need. But Paul is saying here that God gave us the greatest thing, which was Jesus, and God will give us lesser things because God knows what we need, and we trust that God will supply all our needs. And so Paul continues with his question and answer showing the magnitude of God's love. In his book, Not a Fan, Cal Eidelman tells the story of one of his daughters spilling red fingernail polish on one of the cushions of their new white couch. And out of fear, his daughter flipped the cushion over to hide the stain. But later they found out, and when his daughter confessed that it was she asked her mom, "Do you still love me?" To which her mother replied, "You could never make a stain big enough to keep me from loving you." And so often we allow Satan, our past guilt and shame, to destroy us or attempt to destroy us and hold us hostage. But the stain of sin, past, present, or future, will not stop God from loving you. So if you're holding on to anything today that is causing you to question your faith in God or God's love, it's time for you to let it go. Because we are God's elect, which means that God chose us and Jesus died for us while we were sinners. And so Paul points out that it is God who justifies, and only Jesus, our Savior, took on our sins, died on the cross, was raised from the dead, and only he can condemn us. And Jesus sits at the right hand of God as our mediator, interceding for us. And so when we confess our sins, the Bible tells us that God is faithful and just, and he will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So if you have not figured it out yet, God is for you. So, who or what can cause God to no longer love us? Paul lists things that could derail the best Christian: troubles, hardships, persecution, danger, hunger, nakedness, or death. And if Paul were writing this today, he might include racism, war, gun violence, addiction, abuse, hate crimes, natural disasters, political and social unrest. But Paul says that none of these things can separate us from God's love. God does not abandon us regardless of what we are going through. God is near us in our afflictions, and God loves us enough to bring us through life's calamities. Oh, I believe it was in Psalms 34 that the psalmist wrote, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God will deliver us out of them all. Oh, life does not get easier because we are believers, but we can navigate through the treacherous waters because of God's unfailing love. God is for us. And Paul reminds us in verse 37 that we are more than victorious, more than conquerors. Some manuscripts read, through God who loved us. None can defeat God's love. Our trials and suffering, oh, sometimes it may be severe, but God uses them to cleanse us, to bring us to Christian maturity, to make us stronger. And that is what Paul had in mind when he said in verse 28 that all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and who are called according to God's purpose. So it may not feel good and it may not always look good, but God is working it for the good, for your good, because you are called according to his purpose. Suffering and trouble can open the doors to testimonies that cannot be opened any other way. You know, there's some testimonies sitting in here, I believe, this morning. And God made those testimonies because of our troubles, our trials. And see, Paul would know about trials and suffering better than anyone else. He was beaten, he was stoned, shipwrecked, bitten by a poisonous snake. In prison, he was often hungry and thirsty and ridiculed. But despite Paul's suffering, he remained convinced of God's love for him. And that is why Paul could declare at the end of this passage with conviction and confidence that I am convinced that neither death nor life, angels or demons, things present or things to come, height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. I am convinced. Are you convinced this morning that nothing will be able to separate you from the love of God? I am convinced. Nothing surpasses the fact that God loves you and me with everlasting, unconditional, unchanging love. Somebody ought to say amen. Amen. And the thing is that there is nothing that anyone can do about it. Oh, we are free this morning, church, because of the love of God. We are free from condemnation. God is with us. God justifies us. God gave up God's son for us. And Jesus is interceding for us. What does love have to do with it? Everything, when it's the love of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Oh, there's no love, church, like the love of God. And we give God praise this morning for who he is and all that he does for us. And so as Ernest plays softly, if there are those who desire prayer this morning, perhaps this word ministered to you and you needed to be reminded that there's no love like God's love. Or perhaps you need to stand in the gap for someone else. I'm going to invite you to stand where you are as we pray this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. I invite you to stand. If this word ministered to you and you desire prayer. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for who you are and for all that you do, for just being God, and for reminding us, God, that your love for us is grounded in the cross of Christ, and that there is no love greater than your love. And God, we are so thankful that when we were sinners, Lord, you looked down on us. You looked beyond our faults and saw that we needed a Savior. And God, you reached down and you picked us up out of the dirt and out of the mire. And God, you placed us, our feet on solid ground. And so, God, we just thank you. We stand, God, weary and wounded and naked, God. And we ask you to have your way right now in us, in this place, in the name of Jesus. Lord, you know all about us. And so, God, we ask you to forgive us of our sins that we commit by thought, word, or deed. We don't always cross every T or dot every I. But, God, we thank you that you are a loving God and that you are a forgiving God. And for that, we give you praise. And, Lord, you've heard the concerns that have gone forth this morning, those that were spoken and those unspoken. And so, God, we ask that you would move in a mighty way in all our situations, God. You know the things that burden us. And so, God, we ask you to have your way this morning in our lives. And, God, we are so grateful again for your son, Jesus. We are so grateful, God, that nothing would separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus. And the church said, amen, amen, amen. You may be seated. God be the glory for the things that he has done and that he allows us to be a part of. And out of God's love, he invites us to his table. It's to his table. Those who seek to live in peace with one another. And so let us confess our sins together before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will.
We have broken the law. We have failed against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard our need.
Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience.
Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Okay, I invite you to stand and extend signs of reconciliation and peace with one another. And greet someone this morning in the name of a risen Lord. come back together. Amen. Pastor Shula, they told me that sometimes you have to call time. When we start loving on one another, Pastor Shula has to call time. So I thank you that I did not have to call time this morning. Amen. Let us prepare our hearts and minds to receive the offering. Let us share our gifts so that we can make God's deeds known among the peoples, so that our gifts will glorify God and tell others of Christ's wonderful works. And so the ushers will receive your offering. Yes, sir. So much, Shula family, and those others who have your offering, if you would just lift it, the ushers will receive it. Your soloist.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely and long for heaven and home when Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the little sparrow, so I'm sure that he watches over me. I sing because I'm happy. Today I sing because Christ has set me free. For his eye is on the little sparrow, so I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. Yeah. God's eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches over me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Lord God, you bless us with these gifts of love and moments of grace and mercy for this earth and its bounty. And we give you thanks for our lives and for the opportunity to share the gifts that you have given us with others. We say thank you, and we offer you our praise for that. And so now, God, we ask that you would bless these gifts, and may they be signs of your loving kingdom to a world waiting to hear the good news. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for the great Thanksgiving. And I ask that we would just pause for just a minute to think about the great thing that God has done for us through the death and resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ, that we might have eternal life. So let us just pause. Amen. 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 The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Indeed, it is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, to praise you for your mighty acts. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. And when our love failed, your love remained steadfast. And since that time, you have loved us. Your love has been unequaled, unfailing, and unchangeable. And for that, God, we say thanks. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and we join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you did not withhold, but you gave him up for all of us. And when you, by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to you, he broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. And then after the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, he gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we all feast together at his heavenly banquet through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now let us pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who sin against us. Now and forever, amen. There is one loaf, but we who are many are one body in Christ. And so the bread that we break is the sharing in the body of Christ, and the cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Direction of the ushers, will be coming up from the back, down the side aisles, and then exit back to the center. We do have two stations for this side of the church and that side. And also, we also have the individual cups for those who do not want to do communion by intinction, where you dip the blood, the bread into the cup.
Thank you. Amen, amen. Let us pray together. Amen. Let us stand for our closing selection. Holy presence in this place this morning. As my sister sang the song, his eyes on the sparrow, it just kind of reaffirmed everything the message said, that God is for us. Amen. So we thank God for that selection. As you depart from this place, remember, what's love got to do with it? Everything, everything. If we're talking about the love of God. Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever.